count down for the 3, 2, 1. And you're gonna just
okay.
All right, we're ready here.
Check 1, 2. Check 1, 2. Okay. Stand by for radio.
Hello.
3, 2, 1.
The telephone keeps ringing, so I ripped it off the wall. I cut myself while shaving, now I can't make a call. We couldn't get much worse, but if they could, they would. I'm really bound for the best.
Oh, that was smooth. Okay, welcome to Off the Hook, the indecent version. I have a couple of announcements to make that are pretty important, so I hope people pay attention to this because we want to make sure we get this right. We mentioned in the... First of all, if you're here Kevin Mitnick Unplugged, you're in the wrong place because he's not here. He will be here hopefully tomorrow. So we swapped things, and Off the Hook, the indecent version, is tonight. Except, there's been a slight change. It turns out, in fact, that we are being broadcast live over the radio. So what that means, and I hope everybody will participate here, is... What the fuck, man?
Sorry.
Holy shit!
Emmanuel.
What the fuck?
Emmanuel. You can't do that.
Oh shit. Oh. Are we on 7 second delay? Oh fuck, too late. Okay, we're fucked. Well, as long as we're already racked up the charges, we might as well just keep going. Okay,
you're up to
the
indecent
hours.
You're up to
air,
1,000,005 now, I think.
Sorry, what's that?
I think you're up to 1,000,005. Is it three violations?
$325,000 per incident, right? Per utterance.
And don't forget to cover it. We'll be assessing an exit charge.
Did anybody catch a number of utterances? We'll give out a prize. All right, well, at the end of the show, we can have a grand total. All right, I'm all wet now. I'm going to move over there. Guys, introduce yourselves. I'm Emmanuel.
Well, he's Bernie S. Good. We hope to see him in the finals later. I'm Jeopardy Jim.
I'm Mike.
I'm Arseny.
Red Hacked.
Red Bird.
All right.
Oh, you did it already, huh? Okay.
As... Fuck you. It feels good to let loose occasionally. But, you know, we don't want to offend anybody. If anybody's offended, please leave. All right? Seriously. Any children in the house, it's, you know...
Too late.
Yeah, it's too late for you. It's a serious program because what we are facing in radio is all kinds of censorship issues and fear-mongering and over-censorship and self-censorship and all kinds of things like that. And there are all sorts of weird examples. WBAI is where we air Off the Hook normally, and I don't think it's going out over the air now. I hope not. And what that means is that that we broadcast to anybody with radio in a tri-state area, as well as people on the internet. WBAI has, and shortwave too, but WBAI specifically has a history of battling with the FCC. In fact, we were the station, I guess we have the dubious distinction of being the ones to make the indecency standard into policy. I believe it was in 1974. Is that correct, Mike?
73 was when it all started, and it took a few years to wind down.
Okay.
Do folks know this man?
Oh. J- George Carlin, he's caused us no end of trouble.
George Carlin had a bit on a record called Filthy Words, which a DJ called Paul Gorman played on WBAI, Pacifica Radio, at 2 p.m. on Tuesday, October 30th in 1973. Apparently, among his listeners was a man driving in a car with his young son, and that man did not want to be hearing George Carlin talking about filthy words at 2 p.m. on a Tuesday afternoon. So he wrote a letter of complaint to the FCC, and the FCC proceeded to impose a fine on WBAI and Pacifica, the station's owner. Pacifica said that this is a cultural work. It should be allowed on the radio. People want to hear it. But the Supreme Court disagreed with that. And so finally in 1978 is when it all wound down. It was ruled that airing Carlin's bit, Filthy Words, on the radio is not allowed. The FCC is within its rights to fine people for playing this. What's interesting is that the Supreme Court said that an occasional utterance of the word fuck or whatever is okay. They said that. In context, it's fine. And yet the FCC has sort of strengthened its power and now will fine people for a single utterance or a single breast or single anything.
There was the Bono incident where, what was it he said during the Grammy Awards?
Fucking brilliant, I think.
Fucking brilliant, something like that. And the FCC, originally, I think they had the correct answer to that question that, yeah, you know, they were covering something live and this kind of shit happens. Not in their exact words, but then apparently the Congress got all enraged by this. How dare you actually say that using the F word is ever permissible? And so they reversed themselves and said, I believe that any station airing that would be liable, even though they're airing a live news event or entertainment event or whatever you call it, that somehow they're liable. And since then, it's been a very scary time for us broadcasters. But the it all really begins with the George Carlin piece. Do we have that? Because I would love to play the actual piece that started all of this. It's about... And I've always wanted to do this on the radio, but I've never been able to do that. Now, in a free environment like this big room, we can finally do it. It goes about 10 minutes. You think you can stand 10 minutes of George Carlin? All right. Let it rip.
That I was thinking about the curse words and the swear words, the cuss words, and the words you can't say, you're not supposed to say all the time. Because words, if people are into words, they want to hear your words. Some guys like to record your words and sell them back to you if you can. Listen in on the telephone, write down what words you say.
Turn the fucking mic off.
Guy used to be in Washington, knew that his phone was tapped, used to answer, fuck Hoover. Yes, go ahead. Okay. And I was thinking one night about the words you couldn't say on the public airwaves. The ones you definitely couldn't say, ever. Because I heard a lady say bitch one night on television. That was cool, like she was talking about, you know, and the bitch is the first one to notice that in the liturgy, Johnny, right? All right. And bastard you can say, and hell and damn. So I had to figure out which ones you couldn't, and ever. And it came down to seven, but the list is open to amendment, and in fact has been changed. By now, a lot of people pointed things out to me, and I noticed some myself. The original seven words were shit, piss, fuck, cunt, cocksucker, motherfucker, and tits. Those are the ones that'll curve your spine, grow hair on your hands, and maybe even bring us, God help us, peace without honor. What a burden. And now the first thing that we noticed was that the word fuck was really repeated in there because the word motherfucker is a compound word and it's another form of the word fuck. If you want to be a purist, it doesn't really, can't be on the list of basic words. Also, cocksucker is a compound word and neither half of that is really dirty. The word, the half sucker, that's merely suggestive. And the word cock is a halfway dirty word, 50% dirty, dirty half the time, depending on what you mean by it. Remember when you first heard, like in sixth grade, you used to giggle, I'm the cock crowed three times. Hey, the cock three times, it's in the Bible, cock is in the Bible. And the first time you heard about a cock fight, remember? What? No, I ain't. It's chickens, you know? Then you have the four-letter words from the old Anglo-Saxon fame, shit and fuck. The word shit is an interesting kind of word in that the middle class has never really accepted it and approved it. They use it like crazy, but it's not really okay. It's still a rude, dirty, old kind of gushy word. They don't like that. But they say it like, I say, like a lady now in a middle class home, you'll hear most of the time she says it as an expletive. You know, it's out of her mouth before she knows. She said, oh shit, oh shit, oh shit. If she drops something, oh, the shit, like the broccoli, shit! Thank you. Shit! I won the Grammy, man, for the comedy album. Isn't that great? I really didn't talk about it. Thank you very much, man. Thank you, know, for that and for the Grammy, man, because that's based on people liking it, man. Yeah, that's okay, man. I just let that go, man. Got my Grammy, I can let my hair hang down, man. So, now the word shit is okay for the man. At work, you can say it like crazy, mostly figuratively. Get that shit out of here, will you? I don't want to see that shit anymore. I can't cut that shit, buddy. I've had that shit up to here. I think you're full of shit myself. He don't know shit from shinola, you know that? Always wondered how the shinola people felt about that place. Hi, I'm the new man from shinola.
Hi, how are you? Nice to see you.
Well, I don't know whether to shit or wind my watch. Guess I'll shit on my watch. Oh, these shit is gonna hit the fan. Built like a brick shit house. Oh, he's up Shit's Creek. He's at it. He is, man. I'm sorry. Hot shit, holy shit. Tough shit, eat shit. Shit-eating grin. Oh, whoever thought of that was ill. He had a shit-eating grin. He had a what? Shit on a stick? Shit in a handbag, always like that. He ain't worth shit in a handbag. Shitty. He acted real shitty. You know what I mean? I got the money back, but a real shitty attitude. Hey, he had a shit fit. Wow. Shit fit. Whew. Glad I wasn't there. All the animals. Bullshit, horse shit, cow shit, rat shit, bat shit. First time I heard bat shit, I really came apart. Guy in Oklahoma, Boggs, said it, man. Ah, bat shit! Bear reminded me of that last night. I've gone across some snake shit, and slicker than owl shit. Get your shit together. Should I get off the pot? I got a shitload full of them. I got a shit pot full, right? Shit head, shit heel, shit in your heart, shit for brains. Shit face, hey. Always try to think of how that could have originated, the first guy to say that. You know? Somebody got drunk and fell in some shit, you know? Hey, I'm shit face! Shit face today! Anyway, enough of that shit. The big one, the word fuck, that's the one that hangs them up the most. Because in a lot of cases, that's the very act that hangs them up the most. So it's natural that the word would have the same effect. It's a great word, fuck, nice word, easy word, cute word, kind of. Easy word to say, one syllable, short U. Fuck, you know, it's easy. Starts with a nice soft sound. Ends with a k, right? Little something for everyone. Fuck. Good word. Kind of a proud word, too. Who are you? I am fuck. Fuck of the mountain. Tune in again next week to Fuck of the Mountain. It's an interesting word, too, because it's got a double kind of a life, personality, dual, you know, whatever the right phrase is. It leads a double life, the word fuck. First of all, it means sometimes, most of the time, fuck. What does it mean? It means to make love, right? We're going to make love, eh? We're going to fuck. Eh? We're going to fuck. We're going to make love. We're going to make love, right? And it also means the beginning of life. It's the act that begins life. So there's the word hanging around with words like love and life. And yet, on the other hand, it's also a word that we really use to hurt each other with, man. It's a heavy, it's one that you save toward the end of the argument, right? So you finally can't make, ah, fuck you, man! That's it, fuck! Stupid fuck. Fuck you and everybody that looks like you. It'll be nice to change the movies that we already have and substitute the word fuck for the word kill wherever we could, and some of those movie cliches would change a little bit. Mad fucker is still on the loose. Stop me before I fuck again. Fuck the unk, fuck the unk, fuck the unk, fuck the unk, fuck the unk.
Easy on the clutch, Bill, you'll fuck that engine again.
The other shit one was, I don't give a shit. Like it's worth something, you know?
I don't give a shit.
Hey, well, I don't take no shit, you know what I mean? You know why I don't take no shit? Because I don't give a shit. If I give a shit, I would have to pack shit. But I don't pack no shit because I don't give a shit. You wouldn't shit me, would you?
That's a joke when you were a kid with the worm looking out the bird's ass.
You wouldn't shit me, would you?
It's an 8-year-old joke, but a good one.
By the additions to the list, I found 3 more words that had to be put on the list of words you could never say on television, and they were fart, turd, and twat. Those 3. Fart, we've talked about, it's harmless, it's like tits, it's a cutie word, no problem. Turd, you can't say, but who wants to, you know? The subject never comes up on the panel, so I don't worry about that one. Now, the word twat is an interesting word. Twat.
Hey, right, but twat.
Twat is an interesting word because it's the only one I know of, the only slang word applying to a part of the sexual anatomy that doesn't have another meaning to it. Like snatch, box, and pussy all have other meanings, man. Even in a Walt Disney movie, you can say, we're going to snatch that pussy and put him in a box and bring him on the airplane. Yes, indeed, it's good. Everybody loves it. But twat stands alone, man. As it should. And 2-way words. Ass is okay, providing you're riding into town on a religious feast day. You can't say, up your ass. You can say, stuff it. And there are certain things you can say. It's weird. You just come so close. Before I cut, and I want to thank you for listening to my words, man, fellow space travelers. Thank you, man, for tonight.
Oh, hello. Okay. I'd like to think George Carlin would approve of what we're doing here today. I think he definitely would, and he's been a big inspiration in so many ways. And I think really the only danger anybody had in listening to that piece, if they were driving, was maybe swerving off the road. Because it was just, I mean, you know, if that kind of thing offends you, you're not going to listen to all 11 minutes and 30 seconds of it, now are you? Maybe if you want to write a complaint to the FCC. That's the piece that got us into a whole lot of trouble at WBAI, and that's the piece that the FCC has used in their landmark decision to control what we say and do over the airwaves. And I want to point out that we don't necessarily want to have radio programs where we're using foul language all the time, but there are times and places where it's funny, where it's interesting, where it's newsworthy. There are all sorts of examples of that. And I can just tell by the captivated looks on the people in this audience, you weren't staring at us doing radios, just sitting here like, you know, bumps on a log, which radio's not that exciting to look at. But the piece itself was good, it was interesting, it was artistic, and how dare the FCC call it indecent. So that's my opinion on that. Thank you. On the, what's that? More indecent pictures you're showing us. You want to explain what that one is?
Just a piece of art.
Piece of art? Well, the FCC wouldn't think so. They would call that indecent.
Yeah, look at all the naked kids.
Which one's art?
Oh, my God.
Child porn.
Yeah, they're not exactly enlightened people that make all the laws. And I don't think we should be listening to their interpretation. I think we should make our own interpretation of things. On the subject of what George Carlin touched upon with one of the words, I think well, it's funny because people self-censor more and more, so you get all kinds of weird words like the P word, which I think he made reference to. Not the piss, the P-U word.
P word?
Yeah, no, okay, the Johnny Carson bit. Can we play that?
Oh, pussy.
Yes. Thank you. See, I don't like to say these words. Sometimes this is good.
Some people are, you know, very sensitive souls, so we have to...
You don't like 007 movies, you know, with the villain saying, "My pussy and I will get you, Mr. Bond."
I got to ask you something. Sure. Last night, my son, you know, you were talking about Zsa Zsa Gabor earlier.
Yeah, everybody's talking about
my son said, you know, she was on Johnny Carson's show one time. She came there with a cat on her lap. And she said to you, "Do you want to pet my pussy?" And my son said that you said, "I'd love to if you'd remove that damn cat."
No, I think I would recall that.
Okay.
We did a little checking on this. Now, I remembered this as a 12-year-old kid watching the original. But we did some checking, and Snopes and some other sites say that this never happened. They point to the fact that there's no film, no videotape of this happening on the Carson show, but a lot of Carson's film and tape was erased by NBC. There's this interview with Jane Fonda, but there's no ironclad evidence. But on the other hand, he does in another interview explain that, you know, it was perfectly innocuous. So he talks both ends of it, and NBC says it doesn't exist. But hundreds of people, if not thousands, think they've seen it.
But the interesting thing is that this actually aired on TV. I mean, they didn't use any of the seven words there. But, I mean, you know, the word pussy is certainly considered to be an offensive word by some people. So it's amazing to me that NBC actually aired this.
Even
I don't know
Fonda
if they would today.
Clip. Yeah, even the Fonda clip, the reference to pussy, it's not that you can decide to say one or the other. The reference is clearly to both meanings of the word, one of which the FCC should have said is indecent. So, in other words, they're blowing off their own definition in that clip.
Well, of course, I think this came before the definitions. Do you know what year this is from?
That's a good question.
89?
I'd say 89, yeah.
Okay. Well, the FCC has cracked down a lot more recently, and they're really going after... Right now, the latest thing is they're going after stations that air sports programs. They're listening to see if any of the audience is using swear words. So it's like, how the hell do you control that? You know, you're airing a baseball game and someone, you know, says "fuck you" to somebody in the crowd on the field, and they're liable for that. How is that? They want to end live TV apparently, or live broadcasting in any sense.
Well, they've done that to some extent. Jimmy Kimmel Live premiered about 6 months before the Janet Jackson incident at the Super Bowl. And it was originally live, just the 7-second delay for the patently obscene or seven dirty words. After the Janet Jackson incident, it's taped earlier that evening. So it's had some chilling effect, if not a blatantly overt one. But still, that's something.
And the problem you get, I think, is if you...
What the hell is that?
It's a, you know, a little decoration on someone's yard.
I think that's a pretty good-looking pair of melons.
Sorry to cut you off, Bernie, but usually you're in Philadelphia, and that happens all the time anyway.
Yeah, we show slides in the station. Too bad you don't see them, but it keeps us going and makes us laugh. But I don't know where you found these things.
And none of you ever get to see, even in the studio, what I'm doing in Philadelphia when I'm on the phone.
We were talking about the patently obscene that we wish to avoid. So.
I'd rather be wet.
Perhaps best.
You will if you stay over there.
We're all puzzled by this movement, moving about.
No, I'm just moving over here because I want him to get whatever is...
What, was your mind in the gutter or something? Can you imagine something?
I'm standing in a puddle.
Tell us what you were imagining.
Well, I wanted to bring up some examples of previous programs that aired on radio or television. And there are a number that I can think of off the top of my head. And I'm sure people in the audience can think of these as well. And maybe we can take some questions and answers later where you recall some of the good old days where certain things didn't seem to matter so much. Ever since the 9/11 of broadcasting was the Janet Jackson breast incident. I mean, ever since then, you've had the most paranoid reactions. You've had over-censorship, self-censorship of all kinds of words that aren't even offensive, but TV stations and radio stations are so afraid they don't want to step on anybody's toes, so they err on the side of caution. And they will never not do this, because what's in it for them? Most radio stations are not after free speech, they're after profits. That's what it's about, that's what broadcasting is, selling commercials. Now, many of us have watched Monty Python back in the old days, right? Do you guys remember A Day in the Life of a Stockbroker? Remember that sketch? The stockbroker is walking down the street and all these crazy things are happening. People are throwing spears at other people around him, and he's just blithely going along through his day. He walks into the tobacconist to get a newspaper, and the woman behind there is not wearing a top at all, and he doesn't even notice and just goes on his way. Well, they showed that. They showed that on PBS right here in this country. And it was before the Safe Harbor Hour, I remember, because I saw it as a kid. And yeah, it was kind of shocking, but we survived. They won't show that anymore.
Look how you turned out.
All right.
I hate to tell you.
Bad example, but the point is, they showed all these things. There was a TV show, a British show, again, called Doctor in the House. Anybody ever see this show? Way back. They used to air, you could look this up. Look this up in the old TV listings. The show was made in 1970, so this had to be sometime in the early 70s. It used to air at 7:30 p.m. on Channel 7. That's when TV stations actually aired programs from other countries. 7:30 p.m. Channel 7. And it was taking place in a strip club. And there were strippers, and they were stripping. There were bare breasts being shown at 7:30 p.m. on Channel 7 here in New York. It happened. We survived.
Is it too late for me to file a complaint if I'm still offended?
I think someone should say something, because apparently the people who work at Channel 7 now have no memory of this, because they'll cut anything with even a suggestion of that.
Masterpiece Theater, 1980, I think it was. They did the Emile Zola story, Thérèse Raquin, with the actress Teresa Russell, who some of you may remember from the early 80s, in the title role. And it's a tale of adultery. And in this, she's naked and rolling around, so to speak. And they aired Masterpiece Theater 8 o'clock on a Sunday night in the early 80s.
Yeah, and PBS now is they're practically a commercial network, so they're very afraid of any kind of reaction. And, you know, even the non-commercial stations that I'm affiliated with, I'll give you an example. WUSB is a station out in Stony Brook, terrific place. It's where I got my start. And we're scared shitless, to put it bluntly, because all it takes is one listener calling in saying they heard something that offended them. And you know what? They don't even have to prove that we aired it. We have to prove that we didn't air it. And how the hell do you do that? I don't know. But the safe harbor rule for radio in this country is from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. You can air indecent material, whatever they define that as being. Not obscene material, indecent material. And I guess we can get a little bit into what they consider that definition to be. But at WUSB, well, you know, we decided, well, we better play it safe and make it midnight, just so that there's no confusion. And so, okay, so they make it midnight, and then, well, that was a state, the State University of New York said make it midnight. And then at Stony Brook, we said, well, okay, it's midnight, but let's, just to make it even safer, make it at 12:30. So all this extra censorship on top of the imposed censorship is taking place. And what it boils down to is just a complete cessation of expression. And it's sad to see this happen. But we don't have the funds to fight in the Supreme Court, to take something all the way up there. And have you taken a look at the Supreme Court these days? We're not going to win. So it's a pretty hopeless situation. And I think really the only hope is if someone with a lot of money takes this on. Because I think most of the public gets it. Most of the public can deal with it. Saving Private Ryan, I'll give you an example. That actually aired on commercial TV. And for some reason, the FCC decided that this was a protected work of art. And they allowed it to air in before the safe harbor zone, before 10 p.m.
Prime time.
Yeah, in prime time. And you were able to hear such lines as, out of the frying pan, into the fucking latrine, because it was a work of art, and it was protected, and it was Steven Spielberg.
So is that the real, I think that's the real rule, Steven Spielberg okay, George Carlin not okay.
Apparently. Respectfully, sir, sending men all the way up to Ramel to save one private doesn't make a fucking goddamn bit of sense. Well, I'll tell you what else doesn't make a fucking goddamn bit of sense is all this censorship going on broadcast TV. And the funny thing is, cable TV is not affected by this, yet cable TV voluntarily follows the same rules because they don't want to offend anybody. If they offend somebody, maybe they won't get the FCC on their ass, but they might lose sponsors. Now, an exception to this was that South Park episode where they said shit how many times? Over 100 times. And, you know, I got to give them credit for doing that, but boy, the reaction that got. I mean, come on. It's a word. It's one word. And it's a funny show, and anybody watching South Park, I think, has heard the word shit before.
And the issue is that they have total control over what they're watching. If they didn't want to hear it after the first instance, they could have changed a channel very easily. So,
absolutely. Other countries, this doesn't make a difference at all. Other countries, they don't live under this kind of, I consider it oppression, I really do. We don't cuss on Off the Hook. We don't want to cuss on Off the Hook, but occasionally, we fuck up, all right? Occasionally, somebody calls in, and a word gets out. I mean, we called somebody, this happened a few months ago, we called somebody using, what were we using?
That word, VoIP.
Skype. We were using Skype. We were testing it out for the first time. We called a friend of ours, and she had never used it before, or she was very new to it. And we called her, and as soon as we called her and she picked up, her other phone rang. So what's the first thing you do when something like that happens? You say, oh, shit! And that's what she said. And I'm like, oh, my God. And fortunately, we were in delay, so you didn't hear it. But she was mortified, and I don't think we've heard from her since.
Emmanuel, how does
it's
that...
It's so frightening.
Emmanuel, how does that work? In that instance, you had the seven-second delay, but who actually muted the delayed speech?
I did. I pressed the button. Because it's my ass.
Now, how many times in the past couple of months have you had to push that button?
Not too many times. Our listeners are usually pretty good.
And what goes through your mind? How do you feel when you feel like you have to press that button?
Well, one of the words goes through my mind that I would have to censor, I'll tell you that.
No, but I mean, seriously, what emotions do you feel when you realize you need to press that button under government order? What does that feel like?
It doesn't feel good. I mean, I'm not feeling panic. I'm feeling rather pissed off that I have to do this because in most contexts, I think our listeners can deal with the language. We've had Europeans on our show a number of times. We've had Rob from Amsterdam. We've had Andy from the CCC. And this hasn't happened in a couple of years because we haven't had them on in a couple of years. But when they come on, they just like talk freely and they say, yeah, it got kind of fucked up. And it's like they don't even realize. They're speaking a foreign language. They don't even realize that those words are not allowed. And what I'd like to ask some of the people here when we take some questions. And that's one of the words, too. Can you believe that? You can't say tits. Wow.
That's a good-looking pair of tits.
How long have you been saving that line for? They're speaking a foreign language, and they don't even realize that they're saying these words that are forbidden. And what I'd like to ask the people here is, from your countries, if you're from other countries, are there words? Are there words that are absolutely forbidden for you? Like, I know in England, saying bloody means a lot more than it does here. But you guys still say it on TV, you still say it on the radio. You guys watch Sex and the City, they put that on commercial TV now. I've never seen it, but my God, it's from what I've heard, it's just cut up incredibly from when it originally aired on HBO. And if you watch The Sopranos, that's going to air on commercial TV in a few years, and you won't recognize it because they've made alternate audio for every single episode.
Just panning shots of New Jersey.
The comment was just panning shots of New Jersey.
So, I mean, every shit is going to be a shoot. Every fuck is going to be a frick. You know, it's like everybody knows what the words are, but for some reason that satisfies America and we're not offended.
And can you really imagine those characters saying, oh, shoot, you know?
If you want a preview to this fine Pulp Fiction, it aired on Channel 11 a few years ago. And my God, all the words they made up that were curses that no one ever heard of before. But the violence stays in. Like when they whack Big Pussy in the, how are they going to work that out, I guess? Well, when they shoot him in the head and dump him in the water, I hope I'm not ruining it for anybody, that's going to stay in there. That's okay. It's okay to shoot people in the head and decapitate them and all that kind of stuff, but don't say shit when you do it, because that's going to offend somebody. It's universally screwed up, I think.
Emmanuel, on live broadcasts, like Off the Hook,
I'm coming
and
back.
Lots of others. Thank you. I see this form of censorship particularly insidious, because it imposes it on us on the air in a way that almost makes you feel like you have to overcompensate, because you don't know exactly where the line is, because the government hasn't been completely clear about what's appropriate, what's legal, what's not legal, what can get you a $325,000 fine, and that's to the speaker individually now. This is not to the station. You so far have rung up how many millions of dollars in fines tonight? If this had been aired, seriously, and the FCC has already fined individuals more than once with these high fines. I mean, for the same string of words in the same broadcast. So they're not, you know, they're going to run these consecutively in there. But anyway, the self-censorship thing I find particularly disturbing, because naturally broadcasters are going to overcompensate just to be on the safe side, and that just lowers I call it the homogenization of content, because it just lowers it down to just something so innocuous that it seems to lack meaning.
One of the interesting things that we had to do for Off the Hook is we once played this kind of innocuous German telephone hold music song, which is about how they don't care that you're on hold and, you know, they're bad. This German thing, I downloaded it. I downloaded something called the radio edit version, which I guess means they edit it for length. And the song, which is entirely in German, contains the word Scheiße, which means shit. So you can't play that on American radio. So I had to edit this song in a language I don't even speak. It's entirely possible that if I hadn't bothered to look up a translation, I wouldn't have known, and we would have aired it and gotten in trouble. It's very nebulous.
So someone says tits in Swahili, and we're liable.
We could be.
How do you say tits in Swahili? I'm going to say it. See if I don't.
You know, it's been a long time since I read Catch 22. I'm sure somebody in the audience has read it recently. Isn't there a character in there called Scheißkopf, which is German for shithead? So does that mean you can't read Catch 22, even with the obvious dirty words edited out over the air?
Well, I mean, you can say the words as long as they're not the words. In the TV program Boston Public, remember one of the characters was named Harvey Lipschitz? And they used to say his name all the time. Oh, it's Mr. Lipschitz. They just, Lipschitz, hey, Lipschitz, what's up, Lipschitz? And it was crazy. You knew they were having fun with it. But it's okay because it's part of his name. Or my dog's a little Shih Tzu. Is that a dog? Yeah. And you can say it as long as it's not the word, even though you're using the same exact sound.
And on that word, recently, I'm sure most of you heard on the news that our own chief executive, President Bush, has uttered that word, and in a context to other world leaders, Tony Blair, where he said something to the effect that we got to tell Syria to tell Hezbollah to cut this shit out or whatever. It's an unusual situation now where news organizations, broadcasters, cannot quote the President of the United States or the Vice President, for that matter, when he tells us Senator Leahy to go fuck himself. Stuff like that. You can't quote the President of the United States or the Vice President verbatim without incurring the wrath of the FCC, several hundred thousand dollars in fines. It's really strange.
Well, if anyone's aware of a television station that did play this, I want to know and I want to file a complaint and I want to see what happens.
Well, CNN
okay. is on cable television and they are not subject to these rules even though they mostly abide by them.
Now, we had some debate about this because you have the piece. Do you guys want to see the piece of Bush cursing? You sure you're ready for this? It could be traumatic. We're not sure if this aired on TV or just on the website. Did anybody see it on TV? Where they actually used the S word? You did. Okay. Well, let's air this. This is the report, and then we'll take some questions. So come up to the microphone.
I saw it on BBC World.
Well, of course you'd see it there.
Yeah. Sorry, I can't really make this full screen.
The Mideast dominating this agenda right up literally until the final moments. An open microphone phone capturing a rather frank and dramatic exchange between President Bush and British Prime Minister Tony Blair that highlights some of the tensions among world leaders about the way forward in Mideast stands in sharp contrast to the united front that was publicly presented yesterday by this joint statement among the G8 leaders about the Mideast and the way forward. What happened first this morning, to give you some context, is Mr. Blair and UN Secretary General Kofi Annan went behind closed doors for a meeting and then spoke to reporters and jointly called for an international stabilization force to end the violence in the Mideast. But such a force might require a ceasefire, which is controversial because President Bush has not supported a ceasefire on the grounds that the White House doesn't believe Hezbollah would necessarily follow it. So after meeting with Mr. Annan, Mr. Blair sat down for lunch with President Bush, the other G8 leaders as well, and the President in this conversation expresses frustration that the UN should be doing more to pressure Syrian President Assad to get Hezbollah to stop the violence. We need to be clear that the leaders knew that this was a photo opportunity. Mr. Blair eventually turns off the microphone that was on the table, but not before this.
What about Kofi?
Accurate description of most of what he says.
I think Connie's going to go for a shake.
Right, well, that's all that matters. But if you... You see, it'll take some time to get that together.
Yeah.
But at least it gives people...
It's a process, I agree.
At which you... And
I told her your offer, too.
Well, it's only if it's... I mean, you know, if she's got a... Or if she needs the ground from there, as it were. Because obviously if she goes out, she's got to succeed, as it were. Whereas I could go out and just...
See, the irony is that what they need to do is get Syria to get Hezbollah to stop doing this shit, and it's all that.
Because I think this is all part of the same thing.
Yeah.
Look, what does he think? He thinks if Lebanon turns out fine, if you get a solution in Israel, Palestine, Iraq goes in a right way. He's had it.
No, don't.
No,
well, what was interesting about that, I saw that online, and the title of the clip was the SH underscore T heard around the world. And it didn't really... The description of the video didn't really mention anything about what they were talking about. The big story was that he said shit. The big thing. That was it. Nothing about, you know, the actual what we were going to do and sending Condoleezza Rice and all that. No, it was that he said shit. That was the important part.
Okay, we're into our last few minutes. So if anybody has any questions, the microphone's right up there. Just run up and ask questions. Do we have the slide of what was that statue outside the Justice Department that they actually covered up because they were afraid someone might see it? Breast?
Is it this?
No, it wasn't that. It sure wasn't that.
Okay.
Yeah, that's the one. They actually bought curtains to cover this up so that when they gave speeches, you wouldn't see that behind.
And there's a famous photograph when Attorney General under Reagan, Ed Meese, was Attorney General, when there was some indecency regulations that were being handed down by that right-wing administration. And there were classic photographs by the press of Attorney General Ed Meese standing in front of that statue you know, with the tits hanging out over his head. It was a great picture, and now that's never going to happen because somebody caught hell for it.
I'd just like to point out, there's a radio station in Seattle. There's a radio station in Seattle where the morning talk show host is fighting a lot of this, and he went to a meeting with the FCC representatives, and he said, "Give me a list of words I can't say," and they would never give it to him. And he said, "Well, is this because if you give me a list, it's violating my First Amendment rights?" And they were just kind of silent on that.
Yeah, they will be silent when you ask them specific questions like that, for sure.
Yeah, I would also like to point out that NPR actually aired Bush saying shit, and they're actually he said fine them the maximum amount, and NPR is actually fighting them.
The whole National Public Radio Network, every single station on the network aired the word shit before 10 p.m.?
Yes.
Interesting. This could be a good test case. Oh, there's two sets of microphones. I didn't realize all those people back there. Okay, let's try to get through these fast. Go ahead. Then we'll go to you.
How much of this controversy, the recent controversy over...
Close to the mic.
How much of the recent controversy over obscenity and profanity on television is just manufactured by groups like the Parents Television Council and other lobbying groups and activist groups that basically push people to complain about shows, even if they haven't seen the show?
Oh, it's absolutely contrived by the religious right to get their agenda out there. And if you get a lot of people threatening and writing letters, yeah, it does have an effect. Unfortunately, people on the other side are a little bit more intelligent than that, and they don't all act as one hive, and they don't appear to be as organized. But I think public sentiment is against that kind of a thing. We just had to figure out how to fight it. Okay, in the back there.
Just to give you the UK perspective, they just like on the CNN there, they don't mind you using swear words if it is in context, especially if it's live. But effectively, there's no list and anything. They just complain. If they get a complaint, they'll work it out. So not having a list is a good thing, but also it means that it's up to them whether you get fined or not. And the BBC were put on Jerry Springer, the opera. You may know that's quite offensive to some and has about 300 swear words in it. But although they got 45,000 complaints, they stood firm and said, "We'll show it."
Okay, guys, I'm sorry. We only have time for one more question. The person in back of you.
All right. Talking about not knowing where the line is and sort of not having a list of words, this is kind of the same strategy that the People's Republic of China does in censoring websites, because Baidu and Yahoo and MSN don't know what websites are blocked, and so they do a certain level of self-censorship, and that greatly increases the number of things that don't get through the firewall. And also regarding lipshits, there was if you remember the cartoon Rugrats that was on Nickelodeon, it was intended for small children and stuff. There was a psychiatrist who had that same name, and they were using his name all the time too, somewhat suggestively in some cases, actually.
All right, I want to thank everybody for being part of this historic broadcast, and I hope someday that the recording of this can air over the airwaves in the United States in prime time, and that people will say, "Hey, that was a decent show." Thanks.
The telephone keeps ringing, so I ripped it off the wall. I cut myself while shaving, now I can't make a call. We couldn't get much worse.